Tuesday evening, after tea and compulsory prayers, the last mouse on Earth tried to hide from mankind inside the machine. Just before it died, as the nerve gas eased its sphincter, the last ever mouse dropping caused a slight accident. You may control the progress of this accident on my behalf and with my permission, and lead it up the telepath.
Deus Ex Machina 2. I'm not only going to discuss the game, or the work of art, in this video, however you wish to describe it, but I'm going to go off on a couple of tangents. One of which is a website that I've found which discusses Shakespeare's Seven Ages of Man in the modern world, but also a couple of pages of Mel's book, in which he discusses his vision of value in modern society. Over the last couple of months, this whole subject has gained a bit of a special place in my heart, and in order to work out why, when we get onto the website and discuss some of the figures and ages, and well, you'll work out that it's not too dissimilar to what I've been discussing for some time in other videos on not too dissimilar subjects. This whole thing strikes chords with me. To that degree, I took it upon myself to track down one of these. It's the original Commodore 64 game. Well, I say the original Commodore 64 game, the original was the Spectrum. It has the cassettes, but unfortunately it is missing the poster, which was probably taken out, sellotaped to the wall of some youth who then grew through the ages of man and probably took it down, scrunched it up and threw it in the bin. Such is life. Such is humanity. Such is the poetry of this whole damn situation. But there you go. That's getting philosophical. This is my dictionary from the 1960s, used to belong to my father, and Deus Ex Machina is in here. God, shown in the air, in ancient theatre, divine interposition, or either or other artificial solution of difficulties. So, Which one of those two applies here? Well, I suppose they could both apply. Artificial solution of difficulties, plus sort of playing God here, to a degree. Or did the mouse dropping play God? I don't know. You could take that one of a number of ways. Now, this is Mel's second shot at this. And because modern computing has increased in its power, it's enabled him to merge the music and the experience, and also to be able to put in all the chapters that he wanted to. I did sort of mention it to him in an email that it was kind of ironic that my gameplay was being tracked and monitored by Steam. Yeah, talk about the ultimate god game in reality, but there you go. I didn't get a response from him on that one. Now, the opening is very good. It's impressive. Unfortunately, the game itself, the gameplay felt like I was driving a car with sloppy steering, is the best way that I can put it. And the reflections in some of the areas slowed the game down considerably. even though, you know, the game machine that I was playing it on, you know, it's nothing too special, but it's no slouch. And for it to feel as sluggish as it did, didn't help. There were also a few other changes, like old slippered pantaloon became a buffoon. You'll note a few odds and sods like that throughout. The gameplay was still difficult to work out, as life is difficult to live, indeed. Whether that was deliberate, I don't know, but there you go. Some areas offered no chance of redemption, while in others you're just along for the ride. Some of the percentages seemed to be rigged with top and bottom levels which you couldn't get beyond. So in some cases, you, even though you were able to redeem various bits and pieces, you couldn't reach 100% again. While I found the singing of the original to have more emotive power than Deus 2, some of the music was quite moving, and in some cases I was actually crying, particularly during the senility stage. It did move me to tears once I'd engaged with the whole subject, and I was actually going along with the ride and engaged with it. I think I actually got more out of a passive viewing of my gameplay than I did when I was playing it and sort of in control, because I think there was areas that I was trying to work out and I couldn't. And it was only on a passive review of the gameplay that some of the emotions started to hit. Most of the segments are between 2 to 3 minutes long. There was a few, I think, which went over 4 minutes. And I think most disappointing was one that I was just starting to get engaged with, which was the dance. And it only seemed to last about 40 seconds. Just as I was sort of starting to get, oh, what am I doing here, and starting to get to grips with it, it ended. Annoying. There were a few little games thrown in there. Like finding the pairs was interesting. When you're starting to enter the school child arena, there's on the left, there was a chalkboard which basically said find the pairs, and you actually had to act fast. The minute that you entered a particular area, you had to evaluate it in order to be able to swerve to catch some of the earlier areas if you needed them. That was very interesting. The soldier made absolutely no sense to me at all. No sense. I mean, what the heck was it all about? I mean, how was I supposed to be able to, was I supposed to be able to dodge the various bombs which seemed to be coming in, and I didn't seem to be able to dodge them. I didn't know what the hell was going on. It made no sense at all. Didn't connect. Pain was a challenge, like school, in which when the minute you go through a set of doors, you've only got a fraction of a second to look at what you're looking at. And some of the items serve dual purposes. So it wasn't the item itself, whether it was a syringe, it was actually what was on the syringe, or the bottle of oxygen, or whatever, as to whether it would help you or harm you. Pretty difficult. War crimes are easy. Again, made absolutely no sense to me at all. There were two areas where I could choose a left or a right, and beyond that, guilt also had me scratching my head. It was a triangular segment, and it was quite long, and it was very reflective, with green and red arrows and a dollar sign above. I think it was a dollar sign or something. And I had no clue what the hell it was that I was supposed to be doing. At one point I did notice that one of the green arrows actually lit up. Other areas. Decline, danger warning, and old age. Again, a bit confusing. Didn't know what the hell it was that I was trying to do. but the latter was a bit entertaining. Which pill or whatever you actually picked up would depend on what effect it would have on the vision that you were seeing. But by the time you move into the closing stages, senile, wonder, death and transfiguration, pretty much you just sit back and enjoy the ride and reflect on the whole thing. I won't spoil the ending for you, but unfortunately the ending is sort of spoiled in its own, in Deus Ex Machina 2's own promotion video, which is a bit of a shame, but there you go. My conclusion was that it could have been longer. It teased engagement and then in some cases snatched it away too soon. For someone contemplating Shakespeare's works or wanting to investigate the meaning of life, then this is probably something that will tease the brain. Different people will get different things out of this, depending on the life experiences, how much time they give it, and what angle they reflect on it from. Like I think I said, some sections did move me to tears. In the commentary on the 30th anniversary of Deus, Mel did comment that being in a wheelchair gave him an insight of what is to come for him in extreme old age as he loses the ability to do for himself. Many of us will continue our lives in blissful ignorance of these things until we hit them head on. How many of us ever think we will get old or always be able to manage stairs? To some degree, these are depressing thoughts. Others might take them as a warning and plan ahead, like prepare to move to a bungalow in later life. That's how complicated Deus is, not only entertainment, but provocation, for those willing to open their heart to the message. Like many works of art, it contains both pain and pleasure. I've got two links here currently. One of them is to the YouTube demo of or trailer for Deus Ex Machina 2, and you'll probably as a result of it have a link on Mel's channel, because I think that's where that video is located. The second is going to be to this website, Understanding Shakespeare's Seven Ages of Man in Today's World. I'm just going to go through two of the stages. Old age. In the medieval times, life expectancy hovered around 40, and a man of 50 would consider himself lucky to be alive. Depending on the social or economic class of the person, old age could be harsh, or at best ambivalent. Though the old were respected for their wisdom and experience, most old people suffered due to neglect and degeneration of the physical and mental faculties. Those who were orientated towards religious pursuits fared better than the household man. Today, life is alive and vibrant for a 40-year-old. Old age usually sets in around 70s. Many old people in the modern era are actively involved in social activities, secondary occupations or hobbies. Also, there are good retirement plans and financial devices available to make old age comfortable. It is not uncommon for the youthful senior citizens to go on a trip around the world, or pursue gardening, or golf, or simply start their own business in their backyard. Stage 7. Extreme old age. What Shakespeare talks about in this stage of man is an extreme form of aging, where the person is no longer able to perform basic tasks such as bathing, eating, and going to the toilet. Physical frailty and incapacity no longer allows them the freedom to live unassisted. During Shakespeare's time, it was quite okay to treat old people as senile. In fact, in the Elizabethan era, where slavery and discrimination against women were highly prevalent, ageism was hardly considered a problem. Old people were treated as little children, and as Shakespeare describes this stage as second childhood, it was socially acceptable to treat the old with disdain. Today's society is more humane and sensitive towards seniors. Though ageism still exists and is prevalent in many spheres, with growing awareness, seniors, sans teeth, sans eyes, and sans taste, still live with dignity that ought to be afforded to the elderly. Now, there's quite a discussion to be had there, and one that society has been having for some time and continues to have. I don't know whether whether Mel saw it as ironic that it was as he was preparing on the launch day for Deus Ex Machina 2 that he pretty much had the accident which put him in a wheelchair and gave him a taste of what is to come in old age. Unable to do things for yourself. Quite an experience, I guess. So, you can take a number of different things from this. As you've probably guessed, I am having a few problems. Namely, the batteries. I've decided to, because they're not lasting that long, I've decided to use some of my rechargeables. And these Kodak pre-charged rechargeables don't seem to be holding as they should. In fact, they are actually charging a bit quicker. So, anyway, to a few pages in the book, Deus Ex Machina, and Mel's opinion on value. A ticket to see a provincial symphony orchestra currently costs me no more than 6 pints of beer. Great value, considering there can be 40 musicians working hard to entertain me with their sawings, puffings, pluckings, and hammerings. A ticket to suffer a par venue shit band performing derivative shit compositions in a standard shit venue also costs me 6 pints of beer. Poor value. Half a century ago, when I queued up outside Portsmouth Guildhall for a ticket to my first Beatles concert, I was happy to pay 2 pints of beer for the experience. Amazing value. A year or so back, tickets for the Rolling Stones in concert cost around 200 pints of beer. And I challenge anyone to justify this inflation of expectation and devaluation of live entertainment provided by a popular music combo. Bad value. But when it comes to recorded music, as opposed to live music, the situation has been reversed. My first record single cost me 1.5 pints of beer. It was the perfect rock and roll package called Move It by the snarling cock rocker Cliff Richard, since you ask, and it represented good value. The most recent single I bought cost me 0.4 pints of beer as a download from iTunes. Excellent value. He doesn't state what that was. Now let us apply this system to the cinema. When I first started reveling in movies, viewed through a haze of fug from massed rows of cigarette smokers, my ticket in the stalls cost exactly 1 pint of beer. Good value. Today, when I experience the sensory overload of modern cinema through the stench of prole fodder, my ticket in the stalls costs 2.5 pints of beer, including senior citizens' discount. Questionable value. But if I wait a few weeks until I can download the same movie direct to my Sony Bravia smart TV, it only costs me 1 pint of beer. Good value. For books, the increase in value has been even more radical. Now that we can bypass the parasitical practices of agents, editors, publishers, distributors, wholesalers, and retailers, and pay the authors direct via e-publishing. And as for the classics, both literary and educational, there are so many brilliant books available for 0 pints of beer as downloads that it would take several lifetimes to devour them all. Ludicrously good value. Which brings us to the perceived value of video games. In the early heyday of Automata, we were selling compilation games at the equivalent of 0.7 pints of beer each. That was very good value indeed. By the time I launched Deus Ex Machina in 1984, I had grown as deluded as the fat slob in the guilt level, and I seriously believed that putative players would appreciate the investment I had put into the product, pricing it at double the cost of most other games of the period. Deus Ex Machina cost players 15 pints of beer. That was the sort of real-world value that inspired software piracy on a global scale. As I write this, I have not decided where to pitch the price of Deus Ex Machina 2. For portable versions, I have received advice from some newfound friends at Apple, who know a thing or two about value, and they reckon it should be a mid-priced offering, which works out at around 0.3 pints of beer. My peers have suggested that I give the game away and try and recoup my new investment via sales of this book, the audio, and associated doodahs. This doesn't involve investing pints of beer at all, and replaces direct payment with the promise of selling many mouthfuls of beer sometime in the future, the term for which is freemium. My production partners, for whom the terms piss up and brewery are only distant relatives, would obviously like to replace all notions of freemium with bankable concepts like premium. Meanwhile, I am happy to report that since I am recovered from my adventure in a wheelchair during the production of this game and got into the habit of modest exercise and gym visits, my own slob days were receding and I lost 10% of my body weight. Either that, or I'm host to tapeworms, or cancer, or suffering the curse of a wronged sorceress, in which case I'm probably guilty. And on the very next page you have the guilt level. Yeah, value. And everyone has different visions, values. Yeah, everyone has different values of value and how much value different things are to them at different times in their lives. And also depending on their outlooks. Yeah, there's probably someone somewhere who will justify 200 pints of beer to see the Rolling Stones. Not good value for me personally, but to someone somewhere it probably is. Yeah, many discussions still to be had. But the other thing of that was to hear Mel's opinions of himself at those times, and why he felt that he was justified in pricing Deus Ex Machina as high as he did. And yeah, long story short is, like life, there's no winners, there's no losers. We're all gonna die in the end. And yeah. Yeah. Many discussions still to be had. Bye for now.